The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
Here we go, Skywalkers. This is what you can look forward to on episode 276 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
Oh my gosh, that's my favorite intro I've ever gotten, I think.
How often do people say to you, this is the way?
They say it to me all the time, but I never get tired of hearing it.
All right, now let's talk about the child in the room.
It's ridiculous. He's so cute. I have nothing that I'm allowed to say about that. Well, the scene that I have with Boba Fett, I mean, yeah, it's epic. We do karaoke together.
He's the guy who says, inconceivable.
Inconceivable.
If it's based on enthusiasm, I'm definitely a 10. Hi, I'm Emily Swallow. I play the armorer on The Mandalorian, and I am skywalking through Neverland. This is the way.
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
Best day ever!
Secrets lab.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey, hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, hey, Skywalkers! What way do you want to go today? If this is the way, then you're in for a great time. But right now, we want to welcome you all to Skywalking Through Neverland. We are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. I am Richard Woloski, your tour guide through the many decades of fandom. But now, everyone, please say hello to my sweetie wife, Sarah, or as I call her, Spike, because she can spike that volleyball. Sweetie Spike.
Sweetie Spike, woohoo! I'm now part of canon of the, what is it, My Little Pony canon, because Spike is a character in My Little Ponies.
Well, now you're canon in our everyday life, because we play water volleyball down at the YMCA every couple of days.
It's super fun. We just started last week, and we are addicted now.
And Sarah, she can spike that ball like no one's business.
Yeah, when it was my turn to, what is it, when it was my turn to serve. I was, like, doing really awesome.
Yeah, if you're in the way of that proton torpedo, yeah, you're not going to last.
I got, like, 9 points once.
Yes, you did.
That was amazing.
Going to call you Proton Arm. Proton Arm or the Sweetie Spike.
Aw. Well, thank you, sweetie. But now it's time to give a big Wookiee hug to our family of Skywalkers who are not in the pool with us, but they are here with us on our podcast.
Hey, maybe they can join us in the pool.
Oh,
yeah. Every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at the Long Beach YMCA, we're playing water volleyball.
That's right. Come on down, Skywalkers.
It's a great workout.
But until then, thank you for listening to the show every single week. We just love it when you share our joy in this adventure through fandom.
Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on February the 5th, 2020. So, Sarah, how many more days from right now do we have to wait till we watch Star Wars The Clone Wars, which streams on Disney Plus on February the 21st?
16 days. Little over 2 weeks.
It's going to fly by.
Yeah.
Cannot wait for that. All right. How about the release of the first Marvel film in Phase 4, Black Widow?
Awesome. That is premiering on May 1st, and there are 86 days until then.
All right. Now, how many more days until Star Wars Celebration Anaheim on August the 27th?
204 days.
Once again, it's going to fly by.
That's right.
All right, do you Skywalkers have anything you want us to add to this list? Any other movies or events?
Yeah, let us
know. Or anything. Let us know. Oh, sorry, Teresa. She just informed us she wasn't going to Celebration Anaheim. Don't worry. It's not going to be any fun at all.
No. should we tell everyone what time
yes,
it is?
Yes, let's move on to that.
Okay.
Let's move on to that.
All right, right now it is.
It's 1:27. Good afternoon.
1:27 Pacific Standard Time.
Excellent.
Thank you, Minnie.
Ooh, Rachel, it'll be her first celebration.
Oh, nice.
Well, exciting, Rachel.
Mm-hmm. All right, now, Sarah, who is sponsoring this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland?
We are being sponsored by Small World Vacations. They are a diamond-level Disney vacation planner travel agency and can help you book your next trip to Galaxy's Edge or any other Disney park anywhere in the world, and their service is free of charge. So you just head to smallworldvacations.com for a no-obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
All right, now, coming up on this episode, now get ready for this, we will be talking with Emily Swallow, the armorer from The Mandalorian.
Woo!
Now, big thanks to our Skywalking Through Neverland bounty hunter, Shamim Dana, for making this happen. We gave him the puck and the fob, and it led right to her. And he got her.
That was amazing, yeah.
She was so much fun to talk to, and you can tell she's a huge fan of The Mandalorian.
Yeah, and just being part of this Star Wars world, it's really cool. We also have shout-outs with a Skywalker of the Month, as composed by Rob Dehlinger, and what's coming up on Disney Plus on
Things We Want to Share.
Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
Okay, everybody, let's take it from the top.
Something's happening.
And snap.
What's next? The future. That's our specialty.
Woohoo!
All right, so normally we do what's new with Disney Plus at the end of the show, but you know what? Let's move it up to right now.
Yeah, it's definitely a thing we want to share. So, Skywalking Through Disney Plus. Let's do it.
And we also went to a press event for a Timmy Failure, Mistakes Were Made. So we want to share a few moments from that and tell you what else is coming up on Disney Plus.
One of the things I really want to share is that every week now, what we're going to post, we're going to post an article on Skywalking Through Neverland that will be what's new in Disney Plus. So you can tell what's coming up. Because, yes, you have your weekly shows that come out every Friday, but also there's some random like movies and things each week that are being put on the Disney Plus service that you may not really realize until you read the article that's coming out on SkywalkingThroughNeverland.com. But on our show, we're just going to bring up a few fun items that I think you guys should know about that's coming out this week in Disney Plus. For example, starting this Friday, February 7th, we have the premiere of Timmy Failure, Mistakes Were Made.
And this was based on a book series.
Yes, this is a Disney Plus original film that's coming out exclusively to Disney Plus, and it follows an 11-year-old boy, Timmy. He's in middle school, and he starts his own detective agency with a 1,500-pound polar bear named Total.
Of course.
So it's called Total Failure. And the ensemble cast also includes some of the adults that he has to interact with, including his mom, who is played by Ophelia Lovabond. And you may know her from Guardians of the Galaxy. She is Karina.
She's the pink woman who is the assistant to the collector.
Exactly. The cast also includes Timmy's teacher, Wallace Shawn. And he's the guy, he's Fizzini in The Princess Bride. He's the guy who says, "Inconceivable!
Inconceivable!"
I can't do it that well.
No, I wasn't going to bring that up.
I can't do it at all.
Mm-hmm. No, but you did it very well.
But that's him. Yeah, and he was so cool to see.
Plus, you can see him on Young Sheldon.
Exactly, yeah. And also, there's three kids on the show, one whom Timmy thinks is a Russian secret agent. Ooh. So it's really all about Timmy's imagination, really, and it's imagination brought to life. So it's a really, really heartwarming tale, and it's directed by award-winning filmmaker Tom McCarthy, who also wrote and directed Spotlight.
And we had gone to a press conference and recorded some exclusive audio. But Sarah, how could the Skywalkers out there hear this exclusive audio?
Oh, well, the audio was from two roundtables, one with the kids and one with the adults in this movie, and that will be available to the Skywalking Force. Now, I'll also be writing an article about it, which will come out either tonight or tomorrow, and then you can read up all about Timmy Failure and decide whether or not you would like to watch the film or not, which you should.
The kids were a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
Timmy and three of his friends.
Yes, yes.
There was a big spread outside of the conference room, and the kids went and got a big plate of food.
Right, because they were just coming from, I think, a radio spot.
Yeah, they were been busy all day.
Yeah.
Well, actually, the two little girls, very prim and proper.
Yes, very much so.
And Timmy, the little actor who played Timmy, had a plate full of chips and cupcakes and soda right in his hand. And he would answer questions with a mouthful of food. Very, very kid-like.
Oh, yeah.
It was really funny. If an adult did that, it's like, dude, really? Think this through.
Yeah.
But then the press agent had to come and take the food away.
Yeah, one of the handlers was like, I'm just going to take these.
Yeah, I guess someone would ask him a question. He'd shove his face full of Doritos
and then
try to answer. I thought that was the funniest thing I've ever seen
at
any kind of press conference.
Also, one thing that struck me, about the kids, they were just acting like kids. Like, they weren't really in press conference mode.
I would disagree when it comes to the two little girls.
Okay.
Because they were very prim and proper and prepped.
Okay, but in terms of their conversation, they were just having kind of like a normal conversation, whereas when adults like are answering questions, they kind of wait their turn and stuff, but the kids are just throwing stuff out every interrupting each other. It was cute.
I would bet that the two little girls did have some kind of media training, because they were very well spoken.
So Chloe Coleman and Ai-chan.
And one of the questions I had asked, spoiler alert, was that what did you kids watch to ready yourself for these roles?
Mm-hmm.
And his Timmy's
little Winslow Fegley.
Winslow Fegley, his dad chimed in by saying, yeah, we had him watch a lot of private investigator films.
Double Indemnity.
And one of them was Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid. A 1982 film with Steve Martin.
Yep.
I thought, okay, now I'm on board. If this kid watched this film, this kid is very well prepared.
Nice.
I love that. Have you ever seen that movie?
No, I haven't.
Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid is a film that was written around film clips of private investigator films, where they would get clips from different films, and then they would put them together, and the thread would be Steve Martin. So there'd be a clip of Humphrey Bogart saying something, and they would cut to Steve Martin.
Oh, wow.
So they would construct the story. It's like what they did with Carrie Fisher in Rise of Skywalker. They would construct scenes around the footage they had of Carrie Fisher.
Okay.
They would construct a story around these clips, and Steve Martin was a private detective, and he would run into Humphrey Bogart and all these other film stars of the 20s and 30s.
Wow.
When I was watching the film in 82, I was 13. I had no idea what was going on. But now watching the movie now, it's like, okay, now I see what they're doing.
Cool.
Yeah. It was one of these films that it's very experimental, but something that we've got to watch at some point. So I've never seen this come up on Netflix or anywhere.
I'd love to see it now that you described it.
Sean Young is in it from Blade Runner.
Okay. Well, bringing it back to Timmy Failure.
Let's keep on talking about Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid.
Well, bringing it back to Timmy Failure, we also got to speak with the adults, including Wallace Shawn. And I was really excited to meet him because, well, I love The Princess Bride. And, you know, we see him. He just looks like such a nice guy. And yes, he is like a super nice guy. And out of all the stars we've met at these various press events, he just seemed the most interested in us, like, as individuals. Like, he would look each one of us in the eye and, like, just very curious person. And one of the funny things is, when he walked into the room with the other two adults, he was carrying these two big gym bags from his shoulders.
Like these courier bags, almost.
Yeah! And it's like, What are you carrying? So one of us press actually asked. It's like, what do you have there?
Did you bring us swag there, Wallace?
Yeah, and so he said, oh, that's just a sad legacy of my Jewish heritage. I always seem to be carrying a lot of stuff in case one has to leave suddenly.
Very Kyle from South Park.
It was funny. So we all laughed.
I think those bags weighed as much as he did, but
yeah,
you know what? You gotta do what you gotta do.
It was so cool. So all that to say that Timmy Failure will be arriving on Disney Plus this Friday, February 7th.
Do you know why you're here, Timmy?
Mistakes were made. Greetings, fellow humans. What you are about to see is a historical record of my life as a detective. I live in the shadow of this water tower in Portland, Oregon, a place where things get strange. I am the CEO of my own detective agency.
He's so fascinating.
I could show you around the precinct sometime.
I don't collaborate with law enforcement.
How come?
I have a partner.
Oh, that's cool. Who's that?
His name is Total. He's a 1,500-pound polar bear.
Whoa.
My name is Failure. Timmy Failure.
Go, Timmy!
The name is misleading because I am anything but.
Run!
I am only concerned with one thing.
Timmy!
Greatness. Mistakes were made.
Also on Friday, right now, Disney Plus has their current slate of original TV series. So on Friday, expect new episodes of Diary of a Future President, Disney Family Sundays, Marvel's Hero Project, and One Day at Disney. Also coming out this week, Richard?
Mm-hmm.
Are you ready for this?
I am ready.
On February 9th.
Okay, I'm here.
All right.
I'm waiting.
There's an old movie that's being resurrected.
On the edge of my seat as we speak.
It's Old Dogs.
What?
They're just random movies that are coming to Disney Plus, including Old Dogs.
Is this a Disney matinee classic?
No, no. No, this came out in 2009.
Mm.
Right? Okay. And it stars some of our favorite older actors.
Well, define older actors, because that could mean Humphrey Bogart, or it could be Macaulay Culkin.
All right, hold on. John Travolta and Robin Williams. Well, okay. Well, it's called Old Dogs. Come on.
Okay.
Come on.
Okay.
It's a comedy film. Yeah.
Maybe call it Vintage Dogs, Classic Dogs.
Sure.
Okay.
Classic Dogs. That's funny.
Yeah, I do remember this movie.
Okay.
I've never seen it, and guess what? I'm going to continue that. With not ever seeing this?
But just know that you can watch it for free on Disney Plus.
It's still not an incentive.
Okay. Well, that's all we have to share about Disney Plus this week, but now it's time for Emily Swallow.
This is the way. I can't say it like her. She says it in a very particular way, and I can't replicate that.
This is the way. Yeah, no, it's hard.
When one chooses to walk the way of the Mandalore, you are both hunter and prey. Our secrecy is our survival. Our survival is our strength. This is the way.
This is the way.
The Mandalorian has taken Star Wars fandom by storm. It's unanimous that we all love Baby Yoda, but there's another mysterious character that we adore on the show.
She's the one to go to when you need a new Beskar Steel outfit. She is the armorer. She is Emily Swallow. And we are so excited to have her here with us now on Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is the way, Emily.
Oh my gosh. That's my favorite intro I've ever gotten, I think.
We aim to please.
Can I just have you guys introduce me everywhere for the rest of my life?
Absolutely.
I mean, that's not high maintenance or anything, is it?
No.
Not at all. Not at all. Now, how often do people say to you, this is the way?
They say it to me all the time, but I never get tired of hearing it because I've never had a catchphrase that has caught on so universally. And it's so much fun.
And I believe you were the first one to say it on the show, right?
Yes, I definitely was when I was having to bring down the discipline on those pesky Mandalorians that were fighting.
The foundlings are the future. This is the way.
This is the way. This is the way.
You really commanded that scene. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah. Now, on a scale of 1 to 10, how much of a Star Wars fan are you, with 10 being hardcore?
Well, I mean, I guess it depends on what the rating is based on. If it's based on enthusiasm, I'm definitely a 10. But if it's based on
nice.
All the intricate knowledge, I have learned a lot since I started working on The Mandalorian, but I know that there's still so much that is untapped. I'm continuing to learn.
Yeah, it is really deep.
And we base everything on enthusiasm, so you're a 10.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Every step of the way.
Yay!
So yeah, and we'd love to know how you started with The Mandalorian. What was the process like getting the role of the armorer?
You know, it was remarkably boring. I remember it was a few months before I got married, so I was very focused on that, and I got this audition for something that my agent said they thought was probably Star Wars, but you know, it had like a code name, and I got a couple of scenes that were not attached to any sort of script, because when you're going in for something like that, they want you to know as little as possible. Which always makes for an interesting audition process. But actually, one of the scenes I know now was pretty similar to that scene in Chapter 3 with the other Mandalorians when the fight breaks out and she's talking about their kind of their code of conduct. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I went in with the casting associate, and they told me basically all I knew about the character was that she was a leader of a group of people. They said she was very zen-like. So we tried the scene a couple of times, and then the casting associate, Jason, he said, you know, we've mostly been seeing Brits for this part, because I think it was originally it said British woman in her 50s or 60s. So he said, why don't you do a take with a British accent? So I did that.
Oh, wow.
What?
And then that's how the voice came about, because I guess they liked that version of it.
Our secrecy is our survival. Our survival is our strength.
Yeah, so then I found out that I got it, but I still knew so little about what it was. You know, of course, nothing had been announced, and because they were still trying to keep it so secret, I knew it was part of the Star Wars canon, but didn't know when it took place or who was involved, and didn't really learn that much more until I got to set. I mean, I had a costume fitting that really informed who I realized this the armorer was, because that incredible costume that I get to wear that Legacy Effects built, we had to start working on it a few months out, and they like took a cast of my torso so that they could have it fit perfectly. And as that started to come together, I started to get more of an idea of who she was. And then it wasn't until a few days before shooting that I really got to sit down and talk with Jon Favreau and with Dave Filoni about where this all fit into the Star Wars timeline and where we were and who the armorer was in relation to Din Djarin, our main Mandalorian, kind of the feel that they wanted for her. And John said that one of the things he kept coming back to, which I guess was also something that George Lucas really drew from, was Kurosawa's films. Mm. And kind of that, especially with my character, that attention to order and that very authority that is held very simply and almost gently and isn't contingent on a lot of shouting and pushing and shoving and, you know, but just trusting that you have authority. So that was definitely something that helped with her. And once we started shooting, that was really when we started to find out how these characters needed to move. Those of us who were in masks and, you know, the Mandalorian gear, and kind of what the language of communication was physically for them. So that's how it all kind of came together into what you finally got to see.
What were you told of the armorer's backstory after you got the part?
I really wasn't given a backstory. So I sort of put together that she had been part of a clan before they had to go into hiding. Sort of keeps the Mandalorians that we meet there on Navarro, like keeps them connected and keeps them rooted to essentially their family. Cause I think like for the Mandalorians, like once you are a Mandalorian, you are family. And that's,
yeah.
I mean, that's why I think that brilliant moment in episode 3, when all the Mandalorians come together to defend him, like that speaks so much to this code of, of watching out for each other. Because even though just a few scenes prior, you know, they'd been kind of picking a fight with him and they had problems with him, when push comes to shove, they all came to defend him. And I think that she's the one that keeps them tethered to that, because we're at a time in the universe now where the Empire's fallen, but you know, no real order has been established yet. So we see a lot of like lone rangers and people who aren't connected to anyone else and who are just looking out for themselves. So I love that in the midst of all that, she continues to bring the Mandalorians back to who they are. And she does that with Din Djarin too. And I think, you know, kind of reminds him where he came from. And I think she sees potential in him and sees what he could be. And she kind of encourages him to be better and do better throughout his journeys.
It sounds like you were piecing together your own backstory from what you were shooting and what you were seeing.
Yeah.
Did you ever approach Dave Filoni or Jon Favreau and say, hey, this is what I have. Can we roll this into my character? And is this okay?
Yeah, I talked about it with them and they agreed with what I was coming up with. And, you know, Dave was really the one, thank goodness for him, because not only is he just an incredible human being and a wonderful director, but he is a walking encyclopedia of Star Wars. And so all of us were going to him to say like, okay, I think, you know, I'm coming up with this idea now. Where does this fit into the Mandalorians and what we know about the Mandalorians already and what we don't know? And is this okay? And he kept us grounded in what had already been established with the Mandalorians through those animated series that he had worked on, the Clone Wars. So that was incredibly helpful to have.
Oh, I'm sure, since Dave Filoni is really the one to establish the Mandalorian lore.
Yeah.
Now, you have a history of playing very strong female characters from SEAL Team and Supernatural. So what approach did you take that makes the armor different from those characters?
Well, so much of it was done for me. I mean, just the fact that I was in a mask and a suit of armor. And so I had to move differently. And I had a different voice, like that took care of a lot of it. I will say one thing that I drew from a previous character for was, when I started working on Amara on Supernatural and was faced with the prospect of playing this supernatural, all powerful being, it felt like a tall order. And I found for her that using stillness was a lot more powerful than trying to like convince anyone that I was, you know, that I had a lot of power with a lot of histrionics or anything like that. Cause I think when somebody, the more somebody insists they have power, I think the less we give them that.
Very true.
So there was definitely stillness with her that I used for the armorer. And then part of the, you know, quite frankly, some of the limitations of wearing that suit were really helpful for making her very still and giving her very efficient movement, because I was in that, you know, the set for my armory was very dimly lit and I was wearing that helmet, which had a tinted eyepiece. And so as it was, I couldn't really see very well. So I tried not to have any sudden movements because I would run into things or trip on things, or we were constantly like bonking helmets when, you know, when we had to sit down at that tiny little table that I have that looks so cool, but both of us were having so much trouble sitting, like finding the little stools that we had to sit on. We kept missing them and then we would like run into each other. And
oh, I can't wait to see the bloopers on this.
Yeah, outtakes, Disney Plus.
Yeah, I know. I really hope that they release some sort of outtakes, because I think it's just a whole other side to it that is pretty hilarious.
Wow.
But having those limitations was actually really helpful, because it made me move more slowly with her and want to be much more deliberate in my movements. And I think that ultimately that really helped convey her authority.
Yeah, that's really the way Jeremy Bullock took his role of Boba Fett. Ooh. Very slow and very stealthy and doesn't need to move that fast until he has to.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, let's talk about your costume, because honestly, I saw your outfit with that gorgeous helmet, and you know, I'm not one for wanting to cosplay armor, but when I saw your outfit, it's like, dude, I want to cosplay that. I want to make your helmet. So,
right?
Yeah, it's amazing. So, what was your reaction upon seeing that helmet and your outfit for the first time?
It just took my breath away. I mean, it's beautiful, and it's I mean, the leather is so, that like every single detail is exquisite. And the way that they put together like that skirt so that you know she's a woman, but it's still such a powerful costume. And that beautiful pelt of fur that I have over my shoulders, even though I don't really understand that, if I'm spending all the time around fire, it seems a little bit of a liability. But she hasn't caught on fire yet, so we're okay.
She must have a very good insurance agent.
Yeah, definitely. it helped me so much. And it's great when you have a team that's working on costumes that puts that much attention and thought into it, because then it just helps you establish your character so much more easily. Yeah, I got pretty excited when I first saw it, because I don't think I've ever gotten to wear anything that cool.
Nice.
All right, now let's talk about the child in the room.
Yeah.
What did you think when you first saw Baby Yoda?
It's ridiculous. He's so cute. And I mean, he's just, you know, you're looking at him and you know it's a puppet, but you still just want to like tickle him and pet him. But I mean, I didn't get to see him until we were shooting that last episode, because I read some scripts for episodes that I wasn't in, but you know, I didn't know anything about what was going on with the shooting. So I didn't know, even when I did my scene and encountered him, like just how much of an impact he would have and how much he factors into the rest of the series. I did get super excited that I was the one that got to reveal information about, you know, where he might have come from.
It looks helpless.
It's injured, but it is not helpless. Its species can move objects with its mind.
I know of such things. The songs of eons past tell of battles between Mandalore the Great and an order of sorcerers called Jedi that fought with such powers.
It is an enemy?
No. It's kind we're enemies, but this individual is not.
Oh, yeah.
That was cool. I mean, just like getting to read the word Jedi in the script got me so excited.
Wow.
Yeah, and there's a lot of backstory to unpack there.
Yeah.
But in terms of Baby Yoda, what did the producers say to everyone on set to make sure that Baby Yoda was to be kept a secret, or they would meet the same fate as, like, IG-11?
Yeah. Well, they didn't say anything extra about Baby Yoda, because as it was, we had to sign lots of NDAs, and like every time I wanted to read my script, I had to log into this portal, so it was kind of keeping track of like who was reading the script when, and you absolutely couldn't print anything out.
Wow.
So they were really on top of trying to keep things secret. And even I remember when I got there to start shooting, there had already been, and this was early on because I shot all my stuff in October, November, and they didn't wrap until March. I remember when I got to set, I was in my dressing room. In addition to my costume, there was this black hooded cloak, which I started to call our cloaks of invisibility, because we were required to wear them over our costume anytime we were moving around the lot, because there had been some photographers who were on like rooftops, like outside the studio, but they'd captured some pictures of stormtroopers, I guess. So there had already been some production elements that were leaked.
Oh.
So there wasn't anything that was enforced over and above that for Baby Yoda. We just knew we were supposed to keep everything top secret. And I joke with people that, like, I took a few pictures on set, but didn't share them with anybody, because I joked that, like, I was convinced that as soon as I pulled a picture out, like, some Disney drone would come along and shoot me down.
Yeah, those Disney Plus snipers, they're ones to watch out for.
Yeah.
Now, right now, Sarah is wearing her Baby Yoda shirt, and we're both wearing our Baby Yoda socks.
Yep.
What piece of Yoda Baby Yoda merchandise are you looking forward to getting?
Well, there's an Instagram account called Baby Yoda Daily that I just think is hilarious. It went viral because it started just posting all these Baby Yoda memes, and they started doing some merchandise, including like Baby Yoda yoga leggings. But they have pendant that says Clan of Two on it, and they're going to send me one, and I'm excited about that because I do think, I mean, one of the absolutely brilliant things about Baby Yoda, who officially I was told I'm supposed to call the child, but I think that like that is a lost battle already. But the child, in addition to being adorable and hilarious and all these things, it's just such a brilliant addition to the storytelling, because we have this central character whose face you can't see. But once you introduce the child to the story and you see how he interacts with him, it just humanizes him so much. And you kind of, you know, all these emotions that are going on. And I do love that, especially after in the, at the beginning when he refuses to get his signet, because he said, you know, there was an enemy that helped him and he has all these very mixed feelings about it. I love that the armorer tells him, like, you guys are a clan now, you're a clan of two. And I just think that that's so sweet. And also just, it's so powerful that, you know, the two of them, they, all they need are each other. So I'm excited to get my little necklace.
Do you have any armorer merchandise yet?
I do. I was at a fan convention, Wizard World in Portland, and there were people bringing in the Funko Pop of the armorer. And I didn't have one yet, because what I'm learning is that even when they make tons of merchandise with your character on it, nobody ever gives you anything. So one of the fan, I commented to one of the fans when I was signing it that I didn't have one. And he called around to all these stores in Portland and found one and brought it for me the next day. So now I have a Funko Pop, and I have a helmet that a fan made me. A fan who does a lot of cosplay made me this beautiful replica of the armorer's helmet. It's incredible. So that's pretty great. And I've already put it on and scared my dog with it, and she just barks at me. I have those, and I have an armor t-shirt that matches the one that my dad bought, because he bought one. He has to represent.
Of course.
So yeah, I'm getting some fun stuff.
Do you think you'll be going to Star Wars Celebration Anaheim in August?
I don't know. I have not heard anything about it yet, but I hope so. I think that would be so much fun.
Oh, I'm sure they will bring the whole crew and cast out for this one. And you said you've been to other conventions. Have you seen any armorer cosplayers yet?
I have not seen the armorer yet. I've definitely seen a lot of other Mandalorians, but I think people are still, I've heard a lot of people who say they're working on armorer cosplay outfits, but no, I haven't seen one yet. What I'm really excited about is the day that I get to see like a little girl dressed as the armorer, because that'll be amazing.
That will be so, so cute. And is this the first character where people have cosplayed as you? And I'm guessing there's nothing from like Guiding Light.
No SEAL Team, but people do cosplay Amara from Supernatural. Ooh, and that is a much simpler one to do, because I just wore that black dress for the entire season that I was on there. So it's not, that doesn't require quite as much commitment as building an armorer.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, so I'm glad we're talking to you after the first season is over, because man, in the episode Redemption, when you have that hand-to-hand battle scene between those four stormtroopers, like that was a kick-ass scene, and I don't mind saying that out loud. Like I was like whooping and hollering. So how much of that did you get to film and do yourself?
I wish I could tell you that I had done all of it, and I wanted to do all of it, and our brilliant fight choreographer, he just looked at me and he said, I really appreciate that. We would basically need to stop filming for about a year for you to train to be able to do that.
Oh.
He based a lot of the fight in a martial art called Kali. And so I did work with somebody for the few weeks that I had before we shot that, so that I could help like with transitions in and out of it. But most of that is absolutely an incredibly skilled stunt double, which was also so easy for them to do because you don't see my face. So they were like, listen, let's make this look super amazing instead of, you know, having it kind of awkward as it would have been with me probably.
Yeah. Well, what was your reaction when you finally saw that episode and saw that scene?
And were you there on set when they were shooting that?
No, I was not. So I didn't see it until the episode aired. And I knew, like, you know, that's me like at the very end of it, striking that victorious pose. So I knew, you know, they told me kind of what was going to happen. And then, and I knew at the beginning that they, that's me when they come in and the guy like doinks my helmet with his, with his gun. So I knew the gist of what was happening, but I mean, my husband will tell you, cause we watched that episode together the day it came out. I just sat there with my mouth wide open because I could not believe how incredible it looked. And I mean, I feel so lucky that even though it wasn't me doing the whole fight, that that's my character. And that after seeing her not display any aggression for the entire time, to see her just come out with that and to get rid of the enemy in that way, to protect Din Djarin and his friends, like, was just, oh, it, I mean, it's so cool. I don't have any words. I just start stuttering and
it very much mirrors Yoda, because up until Attack of the Clones, we just saw him hobbling along on his gimmer stick.
Yeah,
but when push comes to shove, you know, he means action. And just like you, oh, you come into my home?
Yeah.
Now, were you on set when George Lucas came to visit?
I was, yeah.
Oh, tell us about that.
Oh, it was incredible. And I stood there listening to him and watching him. And, you know, he's telling me stories when had, you know, probably 50 people around him just hanging on his every word. And what just was so profound to me was thinking back 43, I guess, years ago, when he made that first movie, and knowing how much resistance he came up against in trying to get that movie made, seeing how the stories that he created have stuck with us now for four decades, and how much passion people still have about Star Wars, and thinking about the technology that existed back then. And then when he came to set, and when I got to hear him talk, he was on the sound stage that had like the big green screen that they shot a lot of the stuff with his ship. And so just thinking about like the differences in technology and how we can tell the stories now, but even with the technology, you know, people wouldn't still be interested in Star Wars if it weren't for the heart of those stories. And I think that that's really endured. And that's just such a testament to this dream that he had and this little idea that he brought to life. It's just so profound to me.
Yeah.
Did you get a selfie with him?
I did not. No. Oh. I tend not to ask for selfies. Like the more enamored of somebody I am, the less likely I am to do that.
That makes sense. Oh, yeah.
And I'm sure there'll be other chances.
Yeah. Like, speaking of, I mean, you are one of the few characters that lives, that survives season one. So have you started on season two yet? Is there anything you can tell us?
I have nothing that I'm allowed to say about that.
Okay. Okay. Just shot in the dark, you know.
Those drones are still flying around somewhere.
Okay.
All right. Then just tell us about the scene you have with Boba Fett.
I'm sorry?
I'm just trying to drag something out. I'm trying to catch you off guard.
Oh, the scene that I have. Oh, yeah. Well, the scene that I have with Boba Fett, I mean, yeah, it's epic. We do karaoke together.
Now, wait a minute. I don't think
we
this
make
is true.
Pizza. Oh, yeah.
Oh, that would be funny. Although you can't take. How do you guys eat?
That's what my mom asked. We were watching the third episode together, and, you know, all these amazing things are happening. And the one thing she says is, well, if you can't take your mask off, how do you eat? How do you sleep? But we had that answered in, I think it was chapter 4 when he went.
Yes.
The sanctuary.
Yes. And he, I guess we get to take off our masks when we're in private or when we're around, I'm assuming when we're around other Mandalorians.
Or when you're in front of an open window with a ton of children outside.
I know, right? I thought about that. I think we're all kind of like, wait a minute, that's risky.
Yeah, that was really funny.
Yeah, I think he was just dancing on the line there. It's like, okay, yeah. They see me, then okay, then I can take off my helmet in the future. It's like, all it takes is one person, then all of a sudden I'm free of this.
Yeah, probably the whole time he was like, somebody look over here. Hey,
yeah,
kids.
Really?
Hey, kids.
Yeah, doing the whole, yeah. Oh, did you see me without a helmet? Oh, darn the luck. Now, we're not suggesting that you took any mementos from this set, but if you could, what would it be?
Well, I think if I kidnapped Baby Yoda, I'd get in big trouble.
Oh, yeah.
I would love to have some of the armorer's tools. I mean, I had, you know, that big hammer that is in the fight. There were two versions of that. There was like an aluminum one that was incredibly light and easy to handle. And then there was one that was made from like solid steel and would be, I mean, when I felt the weight of that and knew that that was going to be taken into a battle, I knew that there were going to be some people in trouble. But it was just, it was beautiful. And I, before doing this, I didn't know anything about blacksmithing, and I got to learn a little bit about it along the way. And now since then, it's really cool too. And at this last convention that I did, there were a number of people who came up to me and said that they are blacksmiths, and that's a craft that they have cultivated. And so it's been really cool to learn more details about that.
Awesome.
Wow.
Well, before we let you go, I had one last question, and that is, you worked on the show Timeless, which we love, and it stars Clone Wars alumni Matt Lanter, and you were in this episode, The Salem Witch Hunt, where you played Bathsheba Pope.
She's a witch snitch.
Yeah, right?
No, she was telling on her neighbors.
Do you have like any fun story from that shoot at all?
Oh, goodness. I'm trying to remember now. I'm sure that there were.
Yeah, there was Goran Visnjic was in it. And...
Yeah. Oh, he was lovely. Oh, yeah. I do remember one thing specifically related to him. He was commenting on the name Bathsheba and what an interesting name it was. And I said, well, do you know the Bible story about Bathsheba? And he had never heard that. So a few of us were explaining to him that Bathsheba was this seductress in the Bible and had, you know, brought down King David and all this stuff. And he was just fascinated by that.
Wow.
I remember he said, well, this Bathsheba is very different from that. And I think he was kind of hoping that she would show a more adventurous side.
Yeah, I think Timeless goes right underneath The Mandalorian in our favorite TV shows.
I know.
Oh, what if I love any show involving time travel. When I was growing up, I loved watching Quantum Leap.
Oh, me too. Oh,
so much fun when you get to just jump to different eras and different times.
Definitely.
Wow.
All right. Well, Emily, we know you have to go, but where can our Skywalkers, our listeners, keep up with you on social media?
I am on Twitter and Instagram as Biggie Swalls, which is BIGESWALLZ. And I do really try to respond to messages that people send me, or I've been having so much fun, especially on Instagram, when people send me their fan art. It's fun to tag them in it and to share it with everybody, because people just create some incredible things. And on Facebook, I have a fan page under my name, Emily Swallow. So I'm trying to be hip with all the social media.
Awesome. Awesome.
Sounds like you are. All right, Emily. Well, thank you so much for joining us on Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is the way.
Nice.
Thank you. This was so much fun. It was really great to talk to you guys.
Shout outs. Skywalker shout outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was shared a post? Shout out.
All right, Skywalkers, we love it when you guys respond to our latest episode. Just a little like, hey, I listened. Hey, this was cool. Hey, responding to a question we had. And so we want to give a big shout out to Amanda BB8 on Twitter, because she said, what a fun episode with Mike Quinn. I think Nyan Nub lives.
Woohoo!
That's what it looked like to me in Rise of Skywalker. Thanks for keeping me company at work today. Also, love the new Disney Plus segment. Helps me a lot to stay up to date.
You know who else loves the Disney Plus segment?
Disney Plus.
Yeah.
Disney Press. It's fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think it's important to keep everyone up to speed.
Well, I think I find it fascinating because I get these emails from Disney Press that tells what's coming out for the month. And then by breaking it down by week, I'm like, oh, look at that movie. Oh, look. Oh, I want to watch that. So like I wouldn't have known about the One Day at Disney episode with the organist from El Capitan had I not looked at that list. So
there's so many pages to get through on Disney Plus. And is there a what's new?
What's new? What do you mean?
On Disney Plus. We go to the Disney Plus app.
No, as far as I know, unless it pops up at the very top, like when Aladdin became available, right. You saw it on the banner. But yeah. That's only the really big movies. Something like Old Dogs is not going to pop up.
What? What are you saying?
Yeah, I'm just saying.
Okay, yeah, so there we go. We complete them.
Exactly. All right, in our Facebook group, we had a lot of Skywalkers posting this week, especially about wearing our t-shirts that we have on TeePublic. So Reynold Gobay posted a picture of his Skywalking to Galaxy's Edge shirt and said, getting ready for my first visit to East Coast Batuu.
Ironically, Reynold just had logged off of the SkyTuber.
Oops. Well, sorry, Reynold. You'll have to listen to this later.
So he's going to Galaxy's Edge in Florida at Disney's Hollywood Studios.
Woohoo.
So Reynold, keep us posted on that. I want to see plenty of pictures in a report.
Absolutely. Similarly, John Zuncanaro, he also posted pictures from East Coast Batuu. So he's no longer getting ready. He already went, and he went in his teal Galaxy's Edge shirt. And he said, back in January, I was lucky enough to make it to Disney World and sport this great Skywalking through Galaxy's Edge shirt. I highly recommend this shirt in this color. Received a lot of comments that people loved the design. So thank you, John. And it looked really cool in that teal.
Mm-hmm.
It was really beautiful.
Yeah. All right. Now it's time for the all new Skywalker of the Month jingle as composed by Rob Dehlinger.
The John Williams of podcasting.
Shamim Dana. Shamim is a bounty hunter from Skywalking through Neverland. Shamim Dana, Shamim.
Well, congratulations to Shamim Dana. I think we all know why you got this prestigious honor this month. Because you are the bounty hunter.
That's right. Now, Skywalkers, do you want your own Skywalker of the Month jingle? Well, all you have to do is make sure you're commenting on our social media or on our YouTube videos. We are always looking and watching, and we love any kind of feedback on what we create. So that's why we have this incentive, Skywalker of the Month. And we really want to thank Rob Dehlinger, who is just creating these amazing jingles for us, even though he's really busy with his own band, the Alpha Rhythm Kings.
And you can find out his touring schedule at alpharhythmkings.com. Let's say someone wants to get the Skywalker of the Year honor.
Oh,
what would they have to do?
Well, I'd say if they get us an interview with, who do you think, Richard?
I would say there's a top three.
Okay.
George Lucas.
Oh, John Williams.
And Julie Andrews.
Yeah. Aww.
If you can score us an interview with any of those three, you know what? I would say you would get the Skywalker of the Decade.
Ooh.
Sounds fair.
It does.
Well, that does it for this episode 276 of Skywalking Through Neverland. We want to thank Emily Swallow for coming on and telling us those really fun stories, especially giving us a preview of season 2 where the armor and Boba Fett go out for pizza.
And we also want to thank those of you listening right now. Now, we'd also like to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations. Are you thinking of a trip to Disney parks? Are you heading to East Coast Batuu or West Coast Batuu? Well, you can fill out a get a quote form at smallworldvacations.com today, and their service is free, so you've got nothing to lose, Skywalkers.
Now, you can find us right over there at jedinews.co.uk and at Fanthatrax, as well as skywalkingthroughneverland.com. where you can find other fantastic podcasts such as Sabers and Spells, Talking Apes, and classic Marvel Star Wars comics.
We'll have to do another one of those soon.
Oh, very much. Maybe next week.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, maybe we can record from Galaxy's Edge. Actually, those of you right now who are watching live, later today we'll be live streaming from Galaxy's Edge on YouTube. So make sure to look for that notification too, because we're gonna do a new segment.
Yes, we are.
Should we tell them?
Yeah, let's tell them.
Okay. It's Sporky Asks a Question. And you guys will get to ask questions of our new Galaxy's Edge Spork.
Now you can buy them, and we're going to give one away.
Ooh, that's true. So, yes, we're going to announce the winner tonight as well. Yeah.
So I think we have it in the plans for every Wednesday to go over to Galaxy's Edge and do a Ask Sporky a Question.
It's going to be awesome.
Lots of fun. So join us there, and of course, we'll let you know when we're going to be there on Twitter and Facebook.
And speaking of Twitter and Facebook, we are on social media. So make sure you keep up with us on social media. We are at Skywalking Pod for Twitter and Instagram. We also have our Facebook group. So you search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join. You can also email share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
And we want to ask everyone to please go over there to Apple Podcasts and leave a review. As always, we love to hear what you have to say, and leave as many stars as you want or don't want.
And always remember
that this is the way. And
never land on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dehlinger. Creative consultant, Mark Ogushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said. Water volleyball? Wow.
Volleyball.
That's the sport Sarah plays. You get the ball under the net, like you've been doing, instead of over the net, which works just fine.
Hey, I was doing good.
You were doing very, very well. I was so proud of you. All right, now, Sarah, coming up on this episode, get ready for this. We will be talking with Emily S- No pun intended. Wow.
Swallow. And
things we want to share.
Do we have things we want to share?
Because we also went to a press event. So what's coming up in Disney Plus? Wrapped up with a press event. So, okay, it's legal. We can do it at the front of the show.
There you have it.
All right, I had to work through that one. Our friend Shamim Dana had said, I'm going to go meet Emily Swallow this weekend at the convention. It's like, we would love to get her on the show. We would love that so much.
Well, he made sure that I saw the message and that I got in touch with you. So he was really great about it. He's a sweetheart.
Yeah. He's a great guy. Who has spoken?
We have spoken.
And...